Hello and welcome to this week's online recording of our worship service from St. John's United Church of Christ in Newport, Kentucky. This is the third Sunday of Advent, December the 12th, 2021. And as you can see, we're in a little bit of a different venue for recording our online service today. And that's because tonight at our church at 7 o'clock, we're having a Christmas cantata, Let There Be Christmas, with about 40 musicians, choir members, and a full orchestra. So if you're free tonight and can come at 7 o'clock to St. John's Church in Newport, Kentucky, we'd love to have you. It promises to be a really wonderful evening and really get you in the holiday spirit. Again, that's tonight at 7 o'clock at St. John's UCC in Newport, Kentucky. Today we're talking about joy. During our service, we light the third candle of our Advent wreath. We've already lit the candle of hope the first Sunday. Last week, the second Sunday of Advent, the candle of hope or peace. And today, Gaudete Sunday, it's a different color. It's a lighter color. The pink candle, Gaudete, meaning rejoice from the French. So this is the Sunday of joy. And we're talking about that in our scripture service. Even during the service, when you hear the words from John the Baptist, it sounds a little not so joyful because we're hearing the words of the prophet. But don't worry. You will find what it means to find and understand and celebrate and hopefully practice some Christmas joy after our service today. Thanks for joining us. We're glad you're checking out these services.
Good morning. Our call to worship this morning is taken from Paul's letter to the Philippians, chapter 4. Please join me. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say, rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to everyone. The Lord is near. Do not worry about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is pleasing, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence and if there is anything worthy of praise, we'll think about these things. The invocation. God of hope and peace, you call us home from the exile of selfish oppression to the freedom of justice, the balm of healing, and the joy of sharing. Make us strong to join you in your holy work as friends of strangers and victims, companions of those whom others shun, and as the happiness of those whose hearts are broken. Help us know the deepest joy, which sustains us in all trials and service, and help us share that joy with others who need it as much, if not more, than we do. We make our prayer through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our candle of joy is lit. Now hear these words from the Gospel of John. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may be in you, and that your joy may be full. Here is the unison prayer of Advent number 3. Please join me. Out of the embrace of mercy and righteousness, you have brought forth joy and dignity for your people, O Holy One of Israel. Remember now your ancient promise. Make straight the paths that lead to you, and smooth the rough ways, that in our day we might bring forth your compassion for all humanity. Amen. The scripture reading is from the Hebrew prophet Isaiah, chapter 12, verses 2 through 6. You will say in that day, I will give thanks to you, O Lord, for though you were angry with me, your anger turned away, and you comforted me. Surely God is my salvation. I will trust and will not be afraid, for the Lord God is my strength and my might. He has become my salvation. With joy, you will draw water from the wells of salvation. And you will say in that day, give thanks to the Lord, call on his name, make known his deeds among the nations, proclaim that his name is exalted. Sing praises to the Lord, for he has done gloriously. Let this be known in all the earth. Shout aloud and sing for joy, O royal Zion, for great in your midst is the Holy One of Israel.
As we continue now in our service, we come to our time of prayer together. And each week, as I've been doing, I'm going to ask you to join with me in a little time of silent reflection, silent prayer. And then I will lead us in a brief pastoral prayer and ask you to join me in the words of the Lord's Prayer, the prayer of our Savior at the end, in whatever version you're following, or whatever version you know that prayer. And if you're following along in our online bulletin, the words are printed there for you. Let's pause a moment now on this Sunday when we're considering Advent joy and take some silent time together by beginning with a few nice deep breaths. Gracious and everlasting God, we are in the Advent season, and now it is only about 2 weeks until the Nativity of our Lord, until we celebrate Christmas Eve and Christmas Day and the 12 days of Christmas. As we do so, we want to feel your living presence more and more in us in these Advent days, helping us to prepare, helping us to get ready to celebrate your birth that was then and is now and ever will be coming to us. We want to choose a conscious Christmas, a conscious Advent season where your word becomes more alive to us, where we are able to reach out to those who have trouble celebrating in this season, especially when we speak about joy and about hope. We ask that you help us to understand our own need for your light and your love in our lives. As we wait for your appearing, we observe the darkness and the secrets and the sorrows and the shadows in this world and in our own hearts and our own lives. May the secrets lurking in the underside of our souls be revealed in the light of your presence. But let us not be afraid of that. Let us welcome it as a time of redecorating our souls for Christmas. May our sorrows, which are heavy laden upon our hearts, especially those of us who've lost dear ones or who are going through a struggle right now, may they be relieved and lightened by the presence of your life and your light, touching them and giving them strength, giving us strength. May the shadows cast by worn out or troublesome and gnarled memories be smoothed out, like those places John the Baptist says that the rough places will be smoothed and the mountains leveled by the presence and the power of your love. Through and in Christ, who comes again at Christmas, who is our light and our life, our joy and the love of our inner world, may we know your wisdom and that your love endures in every season. In partnership with us, you provide strength and safety and sustenance. And therefore, in this season, when we remember the hope, the peace, the joy, and the love that you bring, help us in gratitude to find our truest joy in serving others, in serving you, and knowing your presence at the center of our own being. Each day, O God, draw us further into this deepening darkness with a greater awareness of your dawning light, which saves us and lifts us up and gives us hope and joy and peace each day. Now we turn to you in the words of the one who shows us what your life looks like, lived out in human flesh, who told the church to pray like this: Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
And now the offertory invitation. So much growth and transformation is possible when we open ourselves to God using us in new ways. Giving can be a powerful and even joyful thing. When you share in generosity, you're taking part in the kind of experience Jesus modeled, the kind that can transform hearts and lives and move others to serve others in his name.
Thank you.
Now, before we come to today's message, I have two scriptures passages to share with you. The first from the Gospel of Luke, and then from St. Paul's letter to the Philippians. This first reading is from Luke chapter 3, verses 7 through 18. John said to the crowds that came out to be baptized, John the Baptist, that is, "You brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Bear fruits worthy of repentance. Do not begin to say to yourselves, 'We have Abraham as our ancestor.' For I tell you, God is able from these stones to raise up children to Abraham. Even now the axe is lying at the root of the trees. Every tree, therefore, that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire." And the crowds asked him, "What then should we do?" In reply, he said to them, "Whoever has two coats must share with anyone who has none, and whoever has food must do likewise." Even tax collectors came to be baptized, and they asked him, "Teacher, what should we do?" He said to them, "Collect no more than the amount prescribed for you." Soldiers also asked him, "And we, what should we do?" He said to them, "Do not extort money from anyone by threats or false accusation, and be satisfied with your wages." As the people were filled with expectation and awe were questioning in their hearts concerning John whether he might be the Messiah, John answered all of them by saying, "I baptize you with water, but one who is more powerful than I is coming. I'm not worthy to untie the thong of his sandals. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand to clear the threshing floor and to gather the wheat into his granary, but the chaff he will burn with unquenchable fire." So with many other exhortations, he proclaimed the good news to the people. That's the end of our gospel reading. And now hear these four verses from Philippians chapter 4, 4 through 7. "Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to everyone. The Lord is near. Do not worry about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus." Here ends the reading of today's epistle and gospel text. May they add understanding for us in our own Advent journey to discover the child of the manger. Amen. Well, as I said in today's welcome, this is the third Sunday of Advent, and we have lit the candle, the Gaudete candle, the pink candle of joy today. And I'm turning to a work called The Book of Joy, as I was struggling to kind of come to terms with joy in this time when, you know, so much is uncertain in our world. And I remembered this book called The Book of Joy, written by Douglas Abrams, and he really got this book from a meeting of Archbishop Desmond Tutu with the Dalai Lama, two of our great world religious leaders, back in 2015. Archbishop Tutu went to India to visit the Dalai Lama, where he is living in exile. And he spent a week there, and Doug Abrams was able to be with them. And what a occasion that must have been to talk with them and interview them. And the book is a highlight of their conversations, and I want to share some of that. First of all, with this world and all its troubles that we're experiencing right now, one of the key insights that they shared was that suffering is inevitable. Indeed, that's one of the founding planks of Buddhism, the Buddhist religion. But they said how we respond to that, because in every life a little rain must fall, how we respond is always up to us. It's always our choice. And not even oppression, not even occupation can take away the freedom to choose and our ability to respond as God would help us to respond. And remember, both of those leaders, very familiar with occupation and oppression. The Dalai Lama living in exile, and Archbishop Tutu having been the one who helped his country recover from decades of apartheid, of racism in his own country. As their dialogue unfolded, they realized, they talked about eight pillars, eight foundations of joy. And those are really quickly four qualities of the mind and four qualities of the heart. The first four, the qualities of the mind, are having, are seeing, having a new perspective of gaining humility, of a sense of humor, and of acceptance. The four qualities of the heart: forgiveness, gratitude, compassion, and generosity. As they unpacked these, as they talked about what those were, those four pillars of the heart and of the four pillars of the mind, Archbishop Tutu said, "Our human nature has been distorted. I mean, we are actually quite remarkable creatures. In our religions, we say that we are created in the image of God. We are God carriers. It's fantastic. I have to be growing in God likeness in caring for the other. I know that each time that I have acted with compassion, I have experienced a joy in me that I find in nothing else." And that's a key teaching there. That when we act with compassion, we find a joy that nothing else can bring us. He goes on to say, when we practice a generosity of spirit, we are in many ways practicing all of these pillars of joy. Generosity, number one, it brings us a wider perspective in which we see our connection to all things. And this really is an ancient Christian idea going back to St. Francis, in fact, going back to Jesus. This perspective that we have, that we are all connected, that everything is connected. More on that in a little bit. Number two, the humility, the second quality of the mind, humility that recognizes our place in the world and that helps us to acknowledge that in another situation or in other circumstances, instead of being the one helping others, we might be the one needing help. That's humility, whether that need is material or emotional or spiritual. The third quality of the mind, humor. We have to approach life with a sense of humor, especially we have to be willing to laugh at ourselves. We have to be willing to see the irony that life often brings to us and not take ourselves or life in general too seriously. And that, all these added up, the fourth quality of the mind helps us to bring an acceptance to life, to accept things as they come, to live in the now, to live in this moment, rather to continually be yearning for things as we wish them to be, but to live here and now and to understand how we can help ourselves and others in this present time. The four qualities of the heart: forgiveness. We could do a whole series of sermons just on that, but forgiveness is what helps us release what keeps us trapped and our own negativity sometimes. Forgiveness that otherwise of what might have been. And to forgive is really not to really let the other person off the hook, but to let ourselves off the hook, to let go of what's eating us up inside. Gratitude. Gratitude for all that we have been given. And this is also related to that humility and that perspective that we have, because we think that we have earned and that everything we have comes through the sweat of our brow and our own hard work. And that's maybe partly true, but everything we have, all of it and all of creation, is really a gift from God. Number seven, the third compassion of the heart, or the third attitude of the heart, is compassion. This is the core of Christian teaching, the core of all the great world's teachings, rather, really. To see a deep compassion and to be able to look with empathy upon the other. It's again tied in with that humility too, to understand that in other circumstances, we might be the one who needs compassion, who needs help. So the desire to help those who need something from us. And finally, the last, all these things add up to an outpouring of generosity, an urge towards generosity, a wise selfishness that recognizes that in helping others, we are indeed helping ourselves. And that's a key point. I think that's how God works. I think that's how God has set the world up to be, that when we are giving ourselves away, we are actually building up our own spirit, and we are gaining as much as the other person. I've talked to a lot of people over the years who've gone with me to do visits for other people, you know, or to take communion to home, to the homebound. And they always say to me, I think I got more out of that than what I was able to give. And that's been my experience throughout my ministry. As the Dalai Lama put it, in fact, taking care of others, helping others, ultimately is the way to discover your own joy and to have a happy life. So that's my key point about joy today. Christmas, you know, is a time to help us find and live into that kind of joy, a kind of deep joy that we can get from no other way than of being humble and compassionate and generous, of all these qualities of the heart and mind that really are the pillars of joy. We say that Christmas, you know, is about the birth of Jesus, and that's as correct as far as it goes, the birth of Christ. But I want you to remember something today, that Christ is not Jesus' last name. Christ is a title. Christ comes from the Hebrew word Messiah, which means Messiah or anointed, the anointed one who is set apart, one who is given a special task. It's a title, and we are therefore celebrating the birth of an anointed one. But that creative and compassionate and loving spirit of God that does the anointing, that's as old as time itself. In other words, I guess I'm saying that the Christ spirit is as old as time. We are the first generation, really, with our ability to look out into the universe and discover the origins of all that is, to know that Christ was revealed not 2,000 years ago, but about 14.5 billion years ago. The human incarnation of that mystery, this creative and sustaining spirit, this energy, probably came 2,000 years ago to us in a person when we were conscious and able of widespread encounter and really to accept that love. And that came to us, of course, in the birth of Jesus. As Christians, we believe that the Jesus story is the story of how divinity and humanity came together, that Jesus was fully human and fully divine at the same time, and therefore was able to tell us how to follow in his footsteps, how to be disciples of that creation story, of that energy, how to be those generous people that live in deep joy. Christmas and the joy it represents is about how we see the world. It's a mystical hope, as I spoke of a couple weeks ago when I talked about hope, which seems to be hidden from too many of us, but really is at the heart of what we are really always hoping and dreaming about. True mystics and true teachers, true anointed ones like Jesus, never bring bad news. That's what we call the gospel good news. It seems that reality at this sort of hidden deep core is always good. You know, there's only three ways we can really look at the universe. Either it's neutral, it doesn't care about us one way or another, or number two, it's out to get us, or number three, that at its core, the universe is good, that God is good, and that God wants what is best for us. And this is what Jesus came to show in this inner reality to discover this deep joy. When religion doesn't move us to this deeper place, this deeper level, it's all about moralism and ritual. You know, we get lost in that, and saying the right prayers or repeating the right phrases or reading the right books or singing the right songs or doing the right rituals. And those are all pointing to this greater, deeper reality. But we get lost in that, and we get lost in one or two little moral issues by which we start to judge everybody else, you know, as seeing them as somehow apart from God or not full of the Spirit. But that's not the way it is. This gaze at creation, this gaze into our own hearts that Christmas brings us, it brings us back to this deep joy and asks us to take a second look, to respect what happens at Christmas. And remember that respect means to re-see. Spec, like your specs, respec, re-see. We're re-seeing our own gaze at the world and understanding that sometimes it's falling short, that we lapse into this kind of utilitarian gaze. You know, what's in it for me? What does this do for me? What can I get out of it? How can I make money? How can I have an advantage? Does this make me look good? Does it give me pleasure? We so easily fall into turning everything into sort of a egocentric, what's in it for me kind of proposition. And this way of looking at the world, this way of living, doesn't recognize that that's a narrow gaze, that it's pretty empty, really. And it keeps us forever at the center of a very small world. Once again, we realize in Christ we are connected and that everything is connected, that we are all one in God, that we are all created by and children of God. It's not all about us. It's not all about me. It's about all of us together. So our job as we come closer to Christmas and prepare for it in this Advent season is to discover the good and the true and the beautiful in everything. And that doesn't mean being like a Pollyanna. It doesn't mean like being naive about that there's problems and there's suffering and there's evil in the world. But it means if we're centered in that deep joy and in those eight pillars of joy, those eight pillars of wisdom, we realize that the bad is never strong enough to counteract the good. Remember that the incarnation of God is always ongoing, that it's inevitable, and that incarnation is always inevitably resurrection. Incarnation, resurrection, Christmas, Easter. Those two things anchor our Christian faith, don't they? If we are the incarnate children of God, we are also the resurrected children of God. This is a kind of optimism that we have to own, I think, and understand more and more. This way of looking at the world helps us see that God comes into the world in Jesus, the Christ born into the world, is turning this world of upside down, this world of our usual expectations, you know, of what's in it for me. It's helping us see that we have nothing to prove to God, that we don't have to prove anything to God. We cannot earn God's love or approval. It's already been given and guaranteed to us. That's what Christmas means. But we always have the choice to accept that love, and to let it change our vision and our way of living. To bring this to a close, coming back to Archbishop Tutu and the Dalai Lama, who at the close of their week together gave this blessing. So let this be a joyful blessing to you for this third week of Advent. Dear child of God, you are loved with a love that nothing can shake, a love that loved you long before you were created, a love that will be there long after everything has disappeared. You are precious, with a preciousness that is totally, quite immeasurable. And God wants you to be like God, filled with life and goodness and laughter and joy. God, who is forever pouring out God's whole being from all eternity, wants you to flourish. God wants you to be filled with joy and excitement and ever longing to be able to find what is so beautiful in God's creation. The compassion of so many, the caring and the sharing. It says, if God says, please, my child, help me to spread love and laughter and joy and compassion. And you know what, my child? As you do this, you discover joy. Joy, which you had not sought, comes as the gift, as almost the reward for this non-self-regarding and caring for others. As you go about your own preparations for Christmas, buying gifts and preparing to try to bring joy into others' lives, may you find that joy in reaching out and giving through what God has given you. Amen. as we've been doing each week, our benediction for today is a scriptural benediction from Romans and from Colossians. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. And may you be made strong with all the strength that comes from God's glorious power. And may you be prepared to endure everything with patience, while joyfully giving thanks to God, who has enabled you to share in the inheritance of the saints in light. Amen. Thank you.